Good evening, doctors. My name is Rahul Desai, and on behalf of FDC and MedTalks, I hereby welcome you all to this live module of Diabetes Essentials brought to you by Enazal Zero and in memory of Dr. K.K. Agarwal, sir. Dear viewers, in last two sessions, Dr. Kalra, sir, has started off with drug treatment modalities, and so far, sir has discussed on biguanides and sulfonylureas. And today, sir will be taking further topic on meglitinides. Dear viewers, I know that like me, you all are very eager to listen to him. But before I hand over the platform to Kalra sir, let me have the opportunity of announcing the winners of last episode's quiz. The winners are from Delhi, we have Dr. Bimla Kapoor, Dr. Batra, Dr. Manu Sharma, Dr. Verma, Dr. Elwadi, Dr. Sumita Sharma, Dr. Sunil Sharma. From Gujarat, we have Dr. C.F. Shah, Dr. Sanindya, Dr. Rajnikant Shah and Dr. Rupam Sharma. From Haryana, we have Dr. Manish Kumar Jain. From Jammu Kashmir, we have Dr. Imtiaz Shah. Jharkhand, we have Dr. Arsad Razi, Dr. S.S. Rana, Dr. Ravi Bhatt, and Dr. Udaya Kumar. From Maharashtra, we have a very big group, Dr. Anand Purandare, Dr. Anupam Agarwal, Dr. Ashwin Kumar Gada, Dr. Bina Gesota, Dr. Damodar Jaiswani, Dr. Dharmika Tandon, Dr. Arun Dhatikar, Dr. D.G. Parmar, Dr. Girish Gesota, Dr. Kajanan Bandewar, Dr. Harsh Shah, Dr. Hitesh Vora, Dr. Utokshi Zarulliwala, Dr. Jagruti Dabuwala, Dr. Jayshri Salian, Dr. Kirit Lalan, Dr. Kulbushan Tandon, Dr. Nalin Deb, Dr. Neelam Mehta, Dr. Patil, Dr. Pradeep Gavit, Dr. Pratap Singh Patil, Dr. Kamar Memon, Dr. Rajeshwari Sunku, Dr. Sanjay Kanoje, Dr. Sanjeev Desai, Dr. Saroj Narang, Dr. Seema Shah, Dr. Sopan Tuse, Dr. Suman Agarwal, and Dr. Vani Ganpati. Then from Odisha, we have Dr. Gangadhar Rath. From Punjab, we have Dr. Sanjeev Puri. From Rajasthan, we have Dr. Sudhir Jain. From Tamil Nadu, we have Dr. Venkatesan Natarajan and Dr. Rajasekaran Kodakattil. From Uttar Pradesh, we have Dr. Anil Upadhyay, Dr. Arun Kumar Garg, Dr. Ashwani Kumar, Dr. Asma Sahid, Dr. D.K. Agarwal, Dr. Deepak Agarwal, Dr. Irfanullah, Dr. Krishna Bahadur, Dr. Sanjay Mehrotra. And from Uttarakhand, we have Dr. Seema Saxena. And West Bengal, we have Dr. Shantanu Kumar Bhattacharya. So congratulations to all the winners. And I would like to hand over the platform to Sanjay Kalra, sir.
Thank you, Rahul, and warm greetings to everybody. Lots of people have already logged in. And we have so many questions and comments from everyone. So I'm grateful for those as well. We've been speaking about various aspects of diabetes, and for the past 2 or 3 weeks, we've been speaking about pharmaceutical drugs, pharmacological drugs. I hope that my slides are visible now. Rahul, are they fine?
It is visible, sir. There is an option called restart later on. It is visible now.
Visible.
Yes, sir. Visible.
Yeah, okay. All clear. So, for the past couple of weeks, we've been speaking about drug classes. We began with biguanides, that's metformin. We then spoke about sulfonylureas. Now, let's talk about meglitinides. Meglitinides are like a younger sister to sulfonylureas. If we remember this single sentence, meglitinides are a younger sister to sulfonylureas, then we know how to place them in practice. We are all from India. It is common sense, common wisdom that two girls from the same family should not be married in the same house. Similarly, meglitinides cannot be given together with sulfonylureas. So that is one thing to remember. Second thing to remember is that wherever sulfonylureas can be used, so can meglitinides be. There are a few differences between meglitinides and SUs, but these are minor. We'll talk about them later. But the first thing to remember is that do not prescribe sulfonylurea and meglitinide together. Second is, wherever you would want to prescribe SU and you are unable to, either because there is a contraindication or there is a safety issue or even maybe there's an efficacy issue or a tolerability issue, then meglitinides can fill the gap. So armed with this understanding, let's talk about this class of drugs. When we talk of glucose-lowering therapy, we try to classify it. So in general, we've already spoken about this in the past, we classify into three different groups. One is the glucostatic drugs, that is, the insulin sensitizers, metformin and pioglitazone. The second is the glucosidal drugs, the ones which are insulin secretagogues. They act upon the pancreas, upon the beta cell. These are sulfonylureas and meglitinides. And the third is the carbohydrate load reducers or the calorie load reducers or the calorie restriction mimetics. These are voglibose and acarbose, as well as SGLT2 inhibitors. Voglibose and acarbose act by reducing the carbohydrate load in the GIT. They reduce absorption of carbs. SGLT2 inhibitors don't act upon the GIT. They act upon the kidney to increase excretion of carbs, increase excretion of calories, of glucose. With this simple understanding, then it becomes easy to craft a rational prescription for each patient. If your patient has predominant insulin resistance, then you have to give a sensitizer. If your patient has relative insulin deficiency, then a secretagogue would be in order. If it is absolute insulin deficiency, then secretagogues will not work. We will need to give insulin. And if your patient is overloaded with carbs or calories, then a carbohydrate load reducer like an alpha glucose disinhibitor or SGLT2 inhibitor will be needed. The meglitinides are insulin secretagogues. They are secretagogues. They stimulate the release of insulin from the beta cell. Only one analog is available in India, that is repaglinide. It comes as 0.5, 1 and 2 milligram tablets in monotherapy. It is also available as a combination with metformin and as a combination with voglibose. So we can choose whatever we want to give in whatever situation is required. They act in a manner similar to that of sulfonylureas. They act upon the K channels in the beta cell. But the CYP enzymes, which govern the breakdown of sulfonylureas and meglitinides, the metabolism of these drugs are different. So nateglinide and repaglinide are metabolized by a different CYP enzyme. Glimepiride and glycoside are metabolized by a different CYP enzyme. Why this is important is because we did say that the meglitinides are younger sisters to sulfonylureas, but we never said that they are less efficacious sisters. In fact, sometimes the younger sister is the naughtier one in any family. There may be some people who have an abnormality or a mutation in one particular CYP gene. There will be others who have a mutation in the other CYP gene. So you may have people who do not respond to glimepiride or who respond exceptionally well to glimepiride. And those people will have a normal or a neutral kind of a response to meglitinide, that is repaglinide. On the other hand, you may have people who respond very well to repaglinide, but do not respond to glimepiride. So when you've tried a sulfonylurea, before labeling your patient as having what we call, earlier used to call, secondary or primary failure of sulfonylurea or secretagogue, and now we call it inadequacy of secretagogue, before labeling your patient as such, you must try repaglinide. There may be a slight chance that the patient who is not responding to glimepiride can respond to repaglinide. Repaglinide is able to act by insulin secretion, by increasing insulin secretion. It brings down HbA1c. It is as potent as all the other drugs, sulfonylureas, metformin, glitazones, SGLT2 inhibitors. In general, all are the same. But it has relatively less effect on fasting glucose and more on postprandial glucose. So if you have a patient with high postprandial excursion, that is, the difference between PP and fasting is more than 74, then repaglinide is a good drug to use. Why did we get the magic number 74? Look at the definition of diabetes. Fasting more than 126, post-challenge or post-glucose or post-load more than 200. So 200 minus 126 is 74. So that is taken as a benchmark figure, as an arbitrary figure. So now we are trying to find a place for repaglinide in our practice. We have given metformin as first-line therapy to everyone. Now we are considering which secretagogue to add. If your patient has postprandial hyperglycemia and relatively less fasting hyperglycemia, we may wish to consider apraglinide as opposed to glimepiride or glycloside. If your patient takes an early evening meal, maybe patient is JAN, not going to take meal after dusk. Maybe the patient has such a difficult lifestyle that there is no time to have dinner late night. Then again, apraglinide may be better than glimepiride. There is also relatively less weight gain with apraglinide as compared to the traditional sulfonylureas. So if your patient is complaining of weight gain on sulfonylurea therapy, you might wish to shift to apraglinide and see what happens. Apraglinide is also very safe to use in renal impairment. So if you have a patient with very low EGFR, the two drugs that we said last time that are safe from the sulfonylurea basket, they are glipizide and glycloside MR. But now we can add apraglinide to that group. It is very safe to use in renal impairment. We already said it is similar in potency to metformin. Wherever you are not able to use sulfonylurea, either because of an efficacy issue, we can just try and see what happens. We may be pleasantly surprised, we may not be. If sulfonylureas are not safe or they are not well tolerated, patient is getting hypoglycemia with SU, even with low dose of SU. Or SU is contraindicated, maybe like we said, because of renal impairment, then we can try this drug. If the patient is on metformin monotherapy or on metformin multi-therapy and is not taking sulfonylurea, maybe metformin plus vildagliptin, metformin plus linagliptin, metformin plus SGLT2 inhibitors, and we feel that there is a need to increase glucose control, to increase our aggressiveness, then we can try to add apraglinide and see what happens. A question was asked, how do we compare voglibose with apraglinide? How do we compare metformin with apraglinide? Metformin is the first line therapy. So first we will give metformin. If it is not efficacious, if it is not tolerated because of GI side effects, or if it is contraindicated, maybe because of a low EGFR, below 30, below 45, then we will consider apraglinide, but not as first line. Apraglinide will be over and on top of metformin unless there is a lack of tolerability or maybe there's a contraindication. If we wish to compare with voglibose, both are equipotent. Voglibose will be a better choice if the patient is taking high carbohydrate meal, especially high rice containing meal, because it acts by reducing the alpha glucosidase enzyme activity. So it will reduce the absorption of carbohydrates. If, however, the patient is taking a normal carbohydrate meal, 55 to 60% carbs, with a lot of protein and a lot of fat, then voglibose is not going to be very effective. So apraglinide will be a better choice. There will be some patients who are not able to tolerate voglibose. They develop symptoms suggestive of gastritis, bloating in the abdomen. Then again, apraglinide may be a safer drug to use. Recently, I learned a new English word. The word is oryzovorus. Oryza comes from Oryza sativa. So India is an oryzovorus country. In oryzovorus population, it would be a good idea to try acarbose and voglibose. But if your population is wheat eating, then maybe apraglinide would be a better choice. If even after using either of these drugs, postprandial control is not achieved, PP sugars are high, then first of all, modify the diet. See where the carbs are coming from. 2, modify physical activity. See if the patient can go for a short walk, not very brisk, but a short walk after the meal. 3, modify the tablet, modify the treatment. So if your patient was on voglibose, add apraglinide. If patient was on apraglinide, add voglibose. And like we said, fixed dose combinations are always available. Do remember that it is not a good idea, especially in long-standing diabetes or complicated diabetes, to ask your patient to go for a brisk walk after a meal, because that can precipitate angina. Normally, the patient will be fine, but after a meal, more blood supply is diverted to the intestine to digest and absorb the food. That creates a relative lack of blood in the heart and in other vascular beds. So you can have postprandial angina even otherwise at rest, but it can be precipitated if the patient goes for a brisk walk, because the blood will not, the blood supply will not be able to meet the needs of the GIT as well as the cardiorespiratory system. Meglitinides have a good advantage, that is that they are short acting. So we can view it as a disadvantage. Patients have to take the tablet regularly 3 times a day, or if they are taking 2 major meals 2 times a day. But we can also view it as an advantage. There is a lesser risk of hypoglycemia, and if hypoglycemia occurs, it will be shorter. So if your patient is getting pre-meal hypoglycemia, symptoms suggestive of hypoglycemia before lunch, before dinner, while on sulfonylurea therapy, we can actually try repaglinide. If your patient is not able to follow a 3+3 meal pattern, that means regular meals and regular snacks, 3 meals, 3 snacks, patient is taking a 2-meal pattern, many of us do that, then again, repaglinide will be a better drug to use. We already said it can be combined with every other OAD except sulfonylureas. So we can give with metformin, with voglibose. We can also give with pioglitazone if we want. And of course, with DPP-4 inhibitors, SGLT2 inhibitors, and basal insulin, it can be used. So just to recap what we have said, patients with variable meal times, irregular meals, just 2 meals a day, patients with renal impairment, the elderly, those who are at high risk of hypoglycemia, repaglinide, fast and feast frequently. So in Haryana, for example, where I work, many of our patients will come and say, I fast every Tuesday, I fast every Friday. Now the Navratras are coming, I will fast for 7 days. I'll just take, both will be fruits. So in all such situations, you can give freedom and empower your patient. Whenever you take a meal, take a tablet. If you skip your meal, skip the tablet. And that is how repaglinide suffices. Repaglinide is also safe to use in the holy month of Ramadan. So you can give that maybe half a dose at suhoor, something like 1 milligram repaglinide, and a full dose at iftar, that would be 2 milligram. It's taken immediately before the meal. The doses we already mentioned are 0.5, 1 and 2 milligram strengths. Theoretically, you can go up to 16 milligram per day, 1-6. But I have never seen anybody doing that. And the maximum that I have ever written is 8 milligram per day, 4 times a day. So 2 milligram, 4 times a day, because the patient was taking 4 major meals. My commonest prescription would be 1 or 2 milligram, 3 times a day. Now, this is the era of cardiovascular outcome trials. And we do know that newer drugs like SGLT2 inhibitors and GLP-1RA have CVOTs. Repaglinide does not have a dedicated cardiovascular outcome trial because they were not required at that time when it was developed. Repaglinide was introduced in India in the year 2000. So at that time, this concept did not exist. But there is a lot of data to show that it has the beneficial impacts on surrogate endpoints. It reduces the thickening of the carotid intima media. It reduces inflammatory markers, reduces platelet activation, improves lipids and endothelial function, and also reduces oxidative stress while increasing adiponectin. Adiponectin is a friendly adipokine, a cytokine which is released from the adipose tissue. The cardiovascular safety is fairly good because there is no signal for increased mortality or increased CV risk with this. Irrespective of whether the patient has had an MI in the past or not, repaglinide is safe to use. And we already mentioned that there are so many surrogate markers which are improved with repaglinide. Even with the nateglinide, that's not available in India, the Navigator study had shown no difference between nateglinide and placebo on CV outcome. There might be hypoglycemia with repaglinide, but it is very, very, very rare. I rarely see this in practice. If it occurs, it will occur just for a few hours. And there you have to be most careful in patients with chronic kidney disease. Also in patients who are taking meglitinide along with insulin. Do remember that if you are prescribing meglitinide along with insulin, you can give it with basal insulin. If you want to give it premix, you should give it antipodal meals. Antipodal means maybe I give biphasic insulin, premixed insulin with dinner, and then I give repaglinide with breakfast and lunch. Or antipodal can mean that I give biphasic insulin at breakfast and then give a repaglinide at dinner, because I wanted to avoid hypoglycemia. At the same time, I wanted to avoid hyperglycemia. Repaglinide is contraindicated in patients with severe liver dysfunction. It is safe in renal dysfunction. And in elderly, frail elderly, we should not use this. We should use safer molecules. So we've discussed about repaglinide. Of course, our discussion will go on and on. I've tried to create a picture of where we can place this in therapy. Only after metformin, unless metformin is contraindicated or is not tolerated. Use it if there is postprandial hyperglycemia or a risk of preprandial hypoglycemia. Use it in patients who have irregular or erratic meal patterns. Use it where you are worried about hypoglycemia. And in general, it's a very safe drug to use. It is, we mentioned initially, it's a little sister of sulfonylureas. So do not prescribe it along with a sulfonylurea. But many times in clinical practice, we have to practice polypharmacy. So our last week's question was, when we are treating a patient with glimepiride and we have to add ciprofloxacin, what do? And the answer was, go ahead, prescribe ciprofloxacin, but increase the frequency of SMBG. Because ciprofloxacin and levofloxacin, gatifloxacin, especially levoflox and gatifloxacin, these two, they have a higher risk of causing hypoglycemia in patients on sulfonylureas. So you want to avoid hypo. Another question was, which of the following is not an indicator of dehydration? The answer is high cholesterol. It's very hot here in Karnal. No sign of the monsoon, irrespective of what the meteorology people tell you. And the commonest condition that my patients are coming in with in the OPD now is heat exhaustion. So what we counsel them is that the heat exhaustion, the exhaustion that you face because of heat is because of dehydration and because of dyselectlitemia. So a good idea would be to ensure that you drink enough water and also replenish your electrolytes. Our patients with diabetes can do that by using a drink like Energel Zero, which is zero calorie, but which has the right electrolytes designed to replace exactly what is lost in the sweat. Let's sweat a little bit on this week's questions. So our first questions, which of the following statements is true? Except. So the answer is, the question is except. Which of the following is false? Meglitinides act by stimulating insulin release. Meglitinides decrease postprandial hyperglycemia. Meglitinides are safer than sulfonylureas because they cause less hypo. Meglitinides act by decreasing insulin resistance. So which of the following is false? They stimulate insulin release, they decrease PP sugars, they cause less hypo, or they decrease insulin resistance, which is false. And our second question, if a patient is admitted with hyperglycemic, that is high glucose, hydrogen, non-ketotic, urine ketones are negative syndrome. So hyperglycemic, hyperosmolar, non-ketotic syndrome, our first priority will be to give oxygen, carbohydrate, fluid replacement, or dietary advice. So what we do first of all, when the patient gets admitted, give oxygen, carbohydrate, fluids, or dietary advice. So that was our talk for today. We have lots and lots of questions today. So let me take them up one by one. Dr. Girish had asked the question on alpha glucose desinhibitors and repaglinide. So Dr. Girish, we did try to answer that. If your patient is taking high carb or high rice diet, then alpha glucose des will be better. Otherwise, repaglinide will be more smooth. Repaglinide, Dr. Girish, cannot be given during pregnancy and lactation. So I have not used it. They lower HbA1c by about 1 to 1.5. In general, from an HbA1c lowering point of view, all the drugs are equipotent, except maybe sulfonylureas are more potent to begin with. Dr. Hitesh Vora, thank you, sir, for being with us. In persons with pre-diabetes, now the American guidelines say that we should start metformin, but the best line treatment is, first line treatment is lifestyle modification. If lifestyle modification doesn't work, and there are multiple risk factors, obesity, family history of diabetes, tobacco smoking, history of premature MI or atherosclerosis in the family, then it would be a good idea to start pharmacotherapy. Metformin would be first line. If your patient is obese and pre-diabetic and you want to reduce weight, then GLP-1 receptor analogs like liraglutide are also a good drug choice. Dr. Greesh asked a question about how sulfonylureas act. The same way that meglitinides act, they act upon the pancreas to increase insulin release. So the secretion is already done and they help in increasing the release of insulin from preformed granules. Dr. Gisota also asks about first phase and second phase insulin secretion. So first phase is what occurs immediately the moment you eat food. And second phase is what will occur about 10 minutes later when gradually the food reaches the stomach and then stimulates the pancreas. The incretins are released and the incretins stimulate the pancreas to begin releasing insulin. Extra pancreatic action of insulin is a point of debate. So there are surrogate markers to show that sulfonylureas have extra pancreatic action, especially for glimepiride and glycyrrhizide MR. But the extra pancreatic action is more relevant with metformin or with incretin-based therapy like DPP-4 inhibitors and GLP-1RA. Dr. Chipa says, Dr. Mehboob says, what are the absolute indications of repaglinide? Between metformin and repaglinide, go for metformin first, unless there's a contraindication. Where I use meglitinide is elderly patients who are not very good at eating meals, who are not sure when they will eat meals. So then I'll start with 0.5 or 1 milligram. Patients who follow the Jain faith and who say that I'm not going to eat dinner after 6 p.m., irrespective of what happens, I will not eat. Then I'm afraid of giving glimepiride or glycyrrhizide. I prefer meglitinide. In some patients, I use meglitinide during the holy month of Ramadan. It is helpful there as well. My commonest dose there would be 1 milligram with suhoor and 2 milligram with iftar. In renal impairment, patient with the EGFR of 30, 35, 25, we try to motivate to take insulin. If they don't agree, then we start RIP. And also, I'd like to convey my greetings to Monuji and to Javed Hassanji, a lot of people who have logged in. So this was about alpha glucose desinhibitors, about repaglinide. Of course, we cannot do justice to the entire pharmacotherapy of diabetes in one webinar, but over the coming 7-8 months, we will try to do that and we'll try to cover each and every aspect of this beautiful subject, diabetes. So thank you for being with us today, and over to Rahul.
So, sir, I'm back. I was traveling, but I could make it 10 minutes after your first session started. So, thank you very much. Because this subject, specifically the meglitinides, have become more or less, I would say, that focus which it had once it was launched in 1998 to 2000, 2001 kind of scenario. Because I was the first one who launched netiglinide in India, in two companies, especially in Glenmark and Alembic. But then, you know, it was a long, long gap. After that, the repaglinide came maybe 3 years down the line. But over the years, with the use of glimepiride and glycyrrhizide metformin combination, and now with the GLP and, you know, the DPP-4 inhibitors, this subject was more or less required. And the way you have positioned that, when, especially in the Jain faith and during the holy month of Ramadan, and people, those who are elderly and have got a very difficult eating pattern, I think this is the day's best message you can give it to all. But in a week when we are celebrating Access to Diabetes Care with Dr. Sanjay Kalra, and I hope with our efforts of last 3-4 months, we must have increased the number of participants, And with this platform, I would request all my doctor colleagues who are watching it continuously, by the time they have understood that with Dr. Kalra on this Diabetes Essential Dr. KK Memorial session, there is something, every day there is something to learn, which they have not probably learned over the years. So as many as doctors they can inform and bring it to our platform every Sunday, 9 p.m., it will help the objective of access to diabetes care in the year, in days to come, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Have a good night.
Thank you, and Jai Hind.
Jai Hind, sir.